No.
Huh?
No. Well, over to the left.
Okay.
Need a photographer? Yeah! Sure!
Thanks.
Thanks.
So where'd you guys go off to all dressed up this morning?
Church. Easter services.
How nice. How nice. What did your pastor preach about this morning at this church service?
I'm sorry?
You know, what was the sermon about?
Oh, Jesus.
Uh-huh.
You know, how he conquered death, right? You know.
Uh-huh.
I mean, and he gave us, you know, life?
Uh-huh.
Abundantly?
Huh. Interesting. Very interesting. Hey, you didn't think my wife and I need to hear about that this morning? That wasn't on your radar? No? Say cheese!
Wow. Anybody say, oh, me? Oh, wow. You know, we've been giving out these six packs now for several weeks. And it's just not a habit that we do. We use this because we believe that people are valuable to God. So we have one more week to invite people. So we're going to pass the bucket. This is not to receive your offering. We're running towards the end. So if you need one, take one and then pass it on down. But as you're doing that, and keep out your six pack. I want to talk about that. Next week is Easter. And we have two great opportunities, 9 o'clock and 11, for you to invite someone to be with us. This year, you can be a difference maker in somebody's life. There's three reasons. I want you to listen to this. Number one, listen closely, listen. Everyone will spend eternity somewhere. And someone will thank you one day for not giving up on them. At 4:44 this morning, the Lord woke me up. And here's what I heard the Lord say. My people, my church, have become too comfortable with people that are lost on their way to hell. They've just decided, well, everything will eventually work out, but it won't work out. It says, unless I come by the way of surrendering my life to Jesus Christ, I'm going to spend eternity in hell separated from God. Eternity is real. And every single person that I see will spend eternity somewhere. And I need to embrace that fact with urgency because I think we become a little lethargic. Number two, don't say no for someone. Over the years, I've learned not to say no when somebody pops in my head that I should invite. You know, we never have the best time to invite somebody. And all too often, as the Lord impresses us, invite that person, invite that person. We were at Lowe's yesterday and Anita was spending some time with one of the salesmen looking at some different things. And at the end, she said, I let him go on and on and on because I felt like the Lord said, invite him to Easter service. So at the end, she said, do you have a church? Nah, I don't go to church. Church would collapse if I came to church. She pulled out a card and she said, I'd like to invite you to come to Easter service. Would you consider that? And he said, I just might consider that. Don't say no for people that the Lord is prompting your heart. You say, well, they wouldn't be interested in coming to church. Don't say no. They think I'm crazy if I ask them. Don't say no. I've discovered that so many people are just one invite away from coming to church. Number three, I'm accountable for the ask. I'm not responsible for the answer. God holds me accountable for the ask. There's a sphere of influence that we all have. And I think sometimes we just get very sleepy about that. And we don't remember how that Jesus saved us and what he did for us. I don't want to bother people. Look, that same power that brought Jesus back from the dead is living inside of us. I invite, it's up to him to do the other. You can see a few empty seats sitting around you. Look, next Sunday is Easter. Our Lord rose from the grave. Let's do everything we can that there's not one empty seat in this building next week. I'd love to see the people standing along the aisles, everywhere we can put them, because I think Jesus Christ deserves that. So would you help me do that? Let's just ask people, invite them to come to church next week. It's a great day. Look, in honor of our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ, would you stand with me this morning? I want you to hold that six-pack in your hand. Yesterday, I emptied all of my cards out yesterday. I had to get another one today. One establishment I go every week to get some supplies for the house. There's a young lady there, and she's always sometimes a little uncomfortable with some of the things that she says. And yesterday the Lord said, yeah, give her a card. No, come on, God, please, no. I mean, she probably might cuss me out, you know. See, I struggle with the same things you do, okay? Lord said, yeah, but what if you're the one invite that makes a difference in her life? Yes, sir. Hey, won't you come to Easter service Sunday? Love to see you. Love you to be my guest. Wow, this is cool. We went over to another place yesterday, a guy I've been working on for 7 years. We always go, I say, hey, you know what's coming up? Easter. Pull out an invite card. Love to see you. He said, yeah, I'll put this in my wallet. Anita said, yeah, with the last seven that you put in, the last 7 years. He said, no, she didn't say that. He said, I'm going to talk to my wife about it. Maybe this Sunday will come. Who is it for you? Lord Jesus, we hold these invite cards in our hand. They're just a tool. There's nothing special about them. And we can just get in the habit that we say, well, it's time to give out invite. No, Lord. It's about inviting people to find life. There's so many people that are down on themselves and feel like God could never use them. God could never care for them. The church doesn't care for them. Lord, like in the last service when I met Mike, Mike said, I've never been to church, but 2 weeks ago, I came with my wife and my life was changed and I'll never be the same again. Lord, I'm so grateful that you changed Mike's life. But there are hundreds of Mikes all around us. And I ask you to lead us to the right person this week to invite, because eternity is such a long, long time. And there's so many people that we care for and we love in our sphere of influence. Don't let us say no for them. Let us say yes in Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. Well, you may be seated. I hope and pray that you'll see many people come to church next week with you. Do you have your Bible with you? If you have your Bible or your smartphone, whatever you use, would you hold it up and let's make this confession today. It's on the screen there. Would you say it with me? This is my Bible. It is the Word of God. It is life to me. Today I receive the Word. I confess my mind is alert. My heart is receptive. I am obedient. And I will never be the same again. In Jesus' name, amen. Amen. Hey, I'm almost disappointed that today is the last day of this series, Destined for Greatness. Several people have said, I know you can get it online on the archives and watch them, but I'd like to purchase the entire set of CDs or DVDs because I think this just, I want to watch it again. So if you would like to purchase one, then you can go out to the information center at the end of the service and give them your name, and they'll tell you all of that. And I'm not even sure how much money it costs yet, so I'm just sort of wading out on water I've never been on. But if you want that, just let them know, and we'll prepare some of those. We've had a memory verse, and it's Ephesians 2 and 10. So every week I put it up on the screen, and I say, let's say our memory verse, and I know you're prone to look on the screen. So today we're not going to put it on the screen, and we're going to see how well we do with our memory verse after all of these weeks. It's Ephesians 2 and 10. Are you ready? Let's go. For we are... which God prepared. Whoa. Now, if your neighbor said that, give him a high five. Say, you did good. You did good. If your neighbor didn't confess or say that scripture, say, we'll give you hope. We'll put it on the screen, okay? Here it is. Let's say it together. Ephesians 2 and 10. Are you ready? For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in them. Destined for greatness. And I gave you a definition for destiny. It's there in your notes. It says something to do in this life, something only you can do. That here are the three things that brings glory to God. Second of all, benefits others and expands the kingdom of God. Another verse that we've been looking at every week now for the last several weeks is Psalm 73 and 24. You guide me with your counsel, leading me to a glorious destiny. Would you look at your other neighbor that was your second choice and tell them you've got a glorious destiny. You got a glorious... Yeah, and don't let the other one feel left out. Turn around and tell them, you too, you have a glorious destiny. I want to ask you just three simple questions today, and I'd like for you to really respond accordingly. First of all, here's the question. We've spent about 8 weeks now looking in this series about destiny. So I just want to ask you this question. Do you believe today that you have a purpose and a God-given destiny to walk out? Let me ask that again. I feel you, Devin. Do you believe that you have a God-given destiny to walk out? Yes. All right. Number two, do you believe that you're destined for greatness? You know, usually what happens on that first one, yeah, I've got, I have a destiny purpose. Do you believe you're destined for greatness? Oh, well, I've got a destiny, but greatness, I'm not sure. You know, that might be good for Dakota, but I'm not sure it'd be good for me. It might be good for Beverly, but I'm not sure for me. No, you got to believe that. So, do you believe you have a destiny? Do you believe you're destined for greatness? And here's the clincher. What are you saying about it? What are you saying about it? One of my favorite verses in the Bible is a simple verse in Psalm 107, verse 2. And it says, let the redeemed of the Lord what?
So.
Do what?
So.
Let the redeemed of the Lord say so. Look, it doesn't say, let the redeemed of the Lord think so or hope so. But it says, let the redeemed of the Lord say so. So I need to say, you know what? I have a purpose and a destiny that God gave me that it's different than anybody else's. And you know what else? I'm destined for greatness because I'm his workmanship and he doesn't make any junk. And you know what? I'm going to begin saying it until I believe it myself, because that's where a lot of us struggle with that. I'm going to tell you this. Nobody in this room is going to go to the next level and accomplish your dreams unless you begin saying out of your mouth and declaring what God says about you. I really feel like with all of my heart that today's teaching is going to be really significant for some of you today. I'm going to share with you a simple discipline that I adopted into my life several years ago. And really just sort of rekindled it in the last year and a half with a lot more discipline. And it's just really simple. And it's going to be so simple when I look at it, you'll say, oh man, why didn't I even think about it? Why haven't I done that? But before I do that, let me just ask you this. How many of you would say in the context of your job, your family, and your relationships that you face some challenging times? Anybody want to say yeah to that? Let me ask it like this. How many of you in your family, in your job, or in relationship had some challenging days last week? You just say, yeah, that's me. Thank you for raising your hand. I'm glad I'm not alone. I want to confess something to you today. I'm always very transparent and very open. And I don't want this to come across like I'm a whiner. But In pastoring this church for 21 years, I've been in ministry for over 46 years. Yeah, I'm that old, Martha. I really am. And so when I think about pastoring this church for 21 years, there are some times that it's significantly physically challenging. And sometimes it's emotionally and spiritually draining. It can be tough. Now, I don't say that because I want you to feel sorry for me, but I want to say that because there have been days in the last 21 years that I've said to Anita or to a friend or to myself, I don't know if I can do this much longer. I'm just tired. I'm just worn out. I'm just frustrated. But you know what? In all the 21 years of pastoring this church, this year, and you can ask Anita about that, this year is the greatest year of my life. Regardless of challenges that we faced, and we've faced some challenges, I don't have to talk about those, but I feel better spiritually, physically, emotionally, and relationally, and I believe it's because of this discipline that I'm going to share with you this morning. Anita said to me this week, she said, I hope this doesn't sound bad, but she said, I just really noticed that you've grown in how that you demonstrate your love to people. And so I thought, oh, okay, does that mean I never loved? It's like in the last service, somebody left and they've been here for like 21 years. And they said, I'm just so glad you've gotten more friendly. And I thought, well, dang, in the Greek sense, what is that? But then I began to realize, you know what? I am more comfortable. Ben said it earlier today. You're just more comfortable in who you are. It's because I believe this discipline. Because here's three things that I know, and it's in your notes if you're taking notes, three truths. Your thoughts become your words. Your thoughts become your words. Your words become your actions. Your words become your actions, and your actions become your destiny. So let me say it again. Your thoughts become your words. What you think, what's in your heart, what's in your mind, will eventually come out of your mouth, okay? And those words then will become your actions. You will direct your life in the direction of those words. And then your actions will become your destiny. Your thoughts matter more than you can ever imagine. The way, listen to this, please hear this today. If you don't hear anything else, please hear this. The way that you think about yourself turns into the reality of your life. The way that you think about yourself turns into the reality of your life. If you draw, please hear this, please let this come into your spirit. If you draw inaccurate conclusions about who you are and what you're capable of doing, you will limit your potential. Look at these verses, Romans 8, 5, and 6. People who are ruled by their desires think only of themselves. Everyone who is ruled by the Holy Spirit thinks about spiritual things. If our minds are ruled by desires, we will die, talking about spiritual death. But if our minds are ruled by the Spirit, we will have life and peace. Your thoughts become your words. Your words become your actions. Your actions become your destiny. Romans 12 and 2. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed. How? How? That you may prove what is the good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Renew your mind so that you can live out the destiny that you have. So how do I do that? It's not like, oh, I'm going to come down to the altar and I'm going to ask you to pray for me, lay hands on me, get rid of these bad thoughts in my mind. No, I can lay hands on you and anoint you with oil until I rub all the hair off your head and you look like a shiny chrome dome and you leave. And I can't change it because only you, God Himself, can't change your thoughts. Only you can change your thoughts about how you see yourself, because how you see yourself through your thoughts will determine your words will determine your actions, and your actions will determine now if you live out the destiny that God has for you. So how do we do that? Well, if you're taking notes, here it is. Number one, remove negative self-talk from your life. Remove negative self-talk from your life. Your inner dialogue matters more than you can ever imagine in your life. I ask you, let's just be transparent, okay? How many of you talk to yourself? Yeah. Man, I love this church. I feel right at home here. I was afraid nobody would raise their hands and I'd really look bad today, okay? But we talk to ourselves, right? And sometimes we talk to ourselves in our mind, right? We have those thoughts and we work with those. Let me just ask you, how do you start your day off? Let me give you a couple scenarios. Scenario number one would be more God-centered. So I'll ask you like this. The alarm goes off. And do you wake up? And this is the common direction of your words. Oh, my God is with me today. My life matters. I've got a great calling. I'm full of faith. My mind is full of life and peace. Well, I've got divine energy to do anything God would ask me to do today. I'm so excited about this day. Today, I'm going to make a difference for the glory of God. Or maybe it's scenario number two. The alarm goes off. You hit the snooze bar. I'm tired. Where's the coffee? Who's that kid pulling me at the edge of the bed? Why did I have these kids anyway? Oh, here I go, another tough week. I got too much to do. I wish I had an extra day this week. I'm so tired, and I got to get up and go to that stupid job. And I work with all those stupid people. And life's so overwhelming. Whatever I try to do, I just can't get ahead. One or two. Now, obviously, I exaggerated, okay? I just became a little evangelistic right there in either one of those. But honestly, if you think about that, where would you place yourself? Over here or over here? You see, your words become your thoughts. Your thoughts become your words, I'm sorry. Your words become your actions, and your actions become your destiny. Here's what you got to know, folks. Your destiny can be delayed by what you're saying or by what you're not saying. Your destiny can be delayed by what you're saying or what you're not saying. Our lives, you might want to write this down because this is pretty good right here. I didn't put it in your notes, but it's tweetable. Our lives move in the direction of our strongest thoughts. Our lives move in the direction of our strongest thoughts. So what negative thoughts are dominating your thinking? There in your notes, I'm going to ask you to just maybe jot down maybe two or three negative thoughts that's just always there. You know, like, I'm never good enough. I never get ahead. I've made too many mistakes. I'm a failure. I don't know what it is. Maybe here, let me just give you a sample of some things I've heard lately. I can't get it all done. I'm not good enough for anything. Hashtag I suck. I'm going to always battle with this thing. I'm so inconsistent. I'm on again and off again with God and my eating. I'm on again and off again with my devotion. I'm just so undisciplined. I'm never going to get ahead. I'm always going to struggle with my weight. I'm just not good enough. I'm an average student. I'll never get into graduate school. My business is never going to be successful. What is it that you consistently keep telling yourself again and again? Because your life will move in the direction of your strongest thoughts. So here it is. Number one, remove negative self-talk from your life. But you say, but how can I do that? Glad you asked. Here's point number two. Replace with positive biblical truths. Declare God's promises over your life. I'm not just saying, be more of a positive thinker. Positive thinking works good. I mean, you go back to sports. We used to stand there and the coach would say, when you're going to shoot that free throw, Mahan, you got to see it go through the goal. Do you see it? Well, you know, it's like go for a golf lesson. You got to see that when you hit that ball, it's going to go. It usually goes in the direction I don't want it to go. Right there's your wrong thing, Steve would say. You're thinking wrong. You're thinking wrong. Now, so I know there's an element to positive thoughts, but I'm not talking about positive thoughts. I'm talking about biblical principles. Matthew 12:34 says, for whatever is in your heart determines what you say. Here, heart talks about my mind, my soul, my emotions. So I can tell what you think about yourself and what you think about your daddy, your spiritual daddy. Can you imagine if you were raised by the richest man in the world? He's your daddy. Who's your daddy? The richest man in the world. And you're just walking around all the time. I'm telling you, I'm just so down and out. I can't afford to do anything. I don't have any money to do anything. I'm just so poor. Nothing ever. I'm never going to get a break. I'll never get ahead. I probably never own my house. I probably never own. And somebody say, excuse me, who's your daddy? Well, my daddy's the most wealthiest person in the world. And you're running around like that and complaining and saying, and your daddy is a wealthy. Listen, folks, our daddy is a King of Kings, the Lord of Lords. He spoke into existence everything out of nothing. And you, his creation, handmade, not on an assembly line. You are his masterpiece. You walk around and say, I'll never be successful. I'll never happen. I'll never own a car. I'll never own a house. I'll never have a great marriage. Come on, pick your head up. Know who you are and begin to say what he says about you. Amen, amen. The message says it like this. Words are powerful. Take them seriously. Words can be your salvation or words can be your damnation. Don't use your words to describe your situation. Use your words to change your situation. Change what you're saying and you'll change what you're seeing. Jim Carrey, in an article that he wrote once about breaking into the industry, he said, when I wasn't doing anything in this town, I'd go up every night and sit on Mulholland Drive just above Hollywood, and I'd look out over the city and I'd stretch out my arms and say, everybody wants me to work. I'm a really good actor. I have all kinds of great movie offers coming towards me. He said, I'd repeat these things over and over, literally convincing myself that I had a couple of movies lined up. He said, then I'd drive down that hill, ready to take on the world, everything that was going, saying, movie offers are coming to me. I just don't hear them yet. But he said, I knew they would eventually come. That's the power of positive thinking and positive phrases. But how much more is it when we begin to apply the words that God says about us into our life? Hebrews 11 and 3 says, by faith we understand that the worlds were framed how? How? By what? The word of God. So that things which are seen were not made of things which are visible. God just looked and go back and read Genesis chapter 1, 8 times. God said, and there it was. Woo! God said, and there it was. Out of nothing. Out of nothing. 8 times. You see, 8 in the Bible is the number of new beginnings. There were 8 people on the ark with Noah, which meant there was a new beginning. How many of you today need a new beginning in your business, in your finances, in your marriage, in your destiny, in your health, in your emotional life? Today could be the day of a new beginning. Listen, nothing happens on earth unless God has said it, or he will say it, or he works through his representatives, you and me, on this planet earth. Folks, listen, you can believe all day long and not see anything happen. Some of you are sitting here today and you believe Jesus was good. You believe he's a good man. You believe in the cross. You believe in the resurrection. But you're never saved by just your beliefs. It says you confess with your mouth and you believe in your heart that he is Christ and you can be saved. Listen, you can believe that you have a God-given destiny. You can believe that you're destined for great things. But if you continue to say negative things about yourself, even though you believe it, it'll never happen until you begin to say what he says about you. Hebrews 3 and 1 says, therefore, holy brethren, partakers of the heavenly calling, consider the apostle and high priest of our confession, Christ Jesus. The word confess means to say the same thing as. So when I say the same thing that God says, listen, I'm not talking about, I'm going to have that car, I'm going to have that car, I'm going to have that car, I'm going to have that woman, I'm going to have that woman, I'm going to have that woman. I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about when I began to say what he says in his word and by faith believe it. He hears my confession and he adds his anointing to that. He adds his anointing to the confession of the word that I'm confessing, and then there's supernatural power that begins to happen in my life. I'm going to tell you, if you'll try this just for a few days, you will be amazed at how your life will change. He said, I'm watching over my word to perform it. So what is the spiritual truth that you can apply to the negatives. If you look on the back of your notes today, I've got some truths. These are spiritual truths that you can begin to confess. Let me just say first of all to the men. I want to just say something especially to the men today, because sometimes, you know, we're a little slack in this area. Look, I'm not going to ask you to pick out a half a dozen. I'm going to ask you to pick out just two or three things. Two or three things from these positive confessions, and begin to say them over yourself every day, and watch your life change. Look at that first one. In all things, I'm more than a conqueror. Maybe you've been saying that negative thing, you know, I just can't get ahead, I'm just such a failure. No, look, start saying, according to Romans 8:37, in all things, I am more than a conqueror. And all of a sudden, our high priest hears that. Whoa, I know that word. That's a powerful word. He adds his anointing to what you're saying, and the supernatural anointing then kicks in, and you move into a new dimension of saying and speaking what God says about you. If you like that, say amen, hallelujah. Here's what we do on the first part of the day. We just give that to God, right? We seek God. We worship on the first day of the week. That's what we're doing here. At the first of the year, we spend that time in fasting and asking God to increase the church. And every Sunday when we come, we bring the first fruits. We make a living, $100 this week, or $1,000, or $1,000,000, whatever it is. 10% of that belongs to God. So we bring that. You see, and then daily we feed on His word, and then we begin to speak out His word, and it changes our life. I'm going to share with you. It's always difficult when you share, because then some people just want to copy something that you say. And these are just spiritual truths that I put into my life. I do these in the morning. I have my phone set for twice during the day at 1 and 5. And it comes up on my screen and says, say your confessions. And it doesn't leave me alone. It keeps reminding me until I check completed. It just keeps coming back. So it's a great discipline. These are the things that I actually say over myself every day. Jesus is first in my life. I exist to serve and to glorify Him. I love my wife, and I lay down my life to serve her. My children and grandchildren will love God and serve Him with their whole hearts. They're my legacy. And I will nurture, equip, train, and empower them to do more for His kingdom than they can imagine. I love people, and I believe the best about them. I'm disciplined. Christ in me is stronger than wrong desires. I weigh what I'm supposed to weigh. I exercise. I eat right. I look good. I feel good. I'm growing closer to Jesus every day. Because of Christ, my family is closer. My body is stronger. My faith is deeper. My leadership is sharper. I am anointed, empowered, equipped, and called to reach people far from God. I am creative, innovative, driven, and focused, and blessed beyond measure because the Holy Spirit dwells in me. I develop leaders. That's not something I do. That's who I am. My words, thoughts, and imaginations are under the power of Christ. I wake up with purpose, direction, and meaning every day of my life. I bring my best, and I do everything with excellence. The world will be different and better because I made a difference. Because of Jesus, I am faith-filled, life-speaking, spirit-directed, fully devoted follower of Christ. According to Ephesians 2 and 10, I am His masterpiece. According to Ephesians 1 and 4, I am chosen. I am strengthened by God who upholds me, protects me, and defends me. I am not easily offended, and I don't hold on to bitterness. According to Psalm 91, I'm steady, and I'll not fall. I'm not alone. God's with me. I'm fierce in confidence and boldness. I'm free according to John 8. I'm healed according to 1 Peter 2 and 24. I'm called and equipped to go after the righteous desires of God. I am secure according to John 10. I won't be shaken. I'm not stuck in worry because Jesus offers a peace this world cannot give. I fight for purity, guarding my eyes and my heart from tempting situations. I wait for God to open up the right doors, and then I take action. I'm not defined by my failures or my successes. I finish what I start, and I will not give up. So I'm just going to challenge you to begin doing some of those things yourself. And I want to put some of that into practice right now. You know, we'll just practice some of this right now. So I'm going to just two or three categories today. And first of all, I want to talk about health and healing. Because so many times people are like that. So today, if you need healing or you need an area of health in your body or for your children, in a minute, I'm going to ask you to stand and I'm going to ask you to make a powerful confession. So if that's you, would you just stand right where you are today and, yep, I need healing. I need a healing in my life. Just go ahead and stand, all right? And I'm going to lead you through this, all right? And I'm going to ask you to pray after me these words. And I'm going to ask you to shout them out. Don't mumble. Well, I just don't want people to hear me. Well, then stay sick and stay in trouble. Handle it yourself. Throughout the Bible, it says, David said, he said, I shouted unto the Lord. In Acts, it says, and when the place where they were assembled was shaken. In other words, they were praying so loud that I think we become too, what's the right word I can use? pansy. That's what I was going to say. Let me say it again. We become too much like a pansy. I think some of our prayers, we need to pray bold prayers. When somebody says, hey, could you pray for me? My child is burning up with fever. I think maybe we join hands with our spouse and we say, in the name of Jesus Christ and by the stripes that were placed on his back, I command healing to begin to flow right now. It is according to his word. I believe that and you're not a respect. I believe we need to start praying bold prayers. So if you need healing today, pray this with me. Lord Jesus, I make this confession today. That you're my Lord and Savior. You're my great physician. You're my healer. And by your stripes, I am now being healed. By your blood, I have victory over every sickness and disease. Lord Jesus, you set before me life and death. I choose life. You set before me blessing and cursing. I choose blessing. I will not fear. For you are with me, and your word is my strength. My body is a temple of the Holy Spirit. Greater is he that is in me than he that is in the world. I declare your greatness. I break every curse of infirmity, destruction, affliction, disease that I have inherited through unbelieving generations. For you, Lord Jesus, became a curse for me, redeeming me that your blessings could come to me. So today, I command all spirits of affliction and sickness and pain and infection, go, leave my body in Jesus' name. I claim the victory of Jesus. And I shout out his name, for he is worthy. Give him praise if you believe that today. Amen. You may be seated. I want to lead us in prayer for financial breakthrough, or if you're struggling in the area of your finances. Now, I know in some of these, we may stand for all of them. We say, I need help in all of those areas. So if that's you, in the area of your finances, if you need help, would you stand? I want to lead us today in a confession for that. You need financial breakthrough. All right, here we go. Lord Jesus, I make this proclamation in faith believing. It is you that gives me power to get wealth. It is you, O Lord, who plants me by a river of living water. And whatever I do, shall prosper. You will give me houses I didn't build, vineyards I didn't plant. I have honored you with my giving and my living, and my harvest will return, and it'll be exceedingly, abundantly, above all that I can ask or imagine. My harvest is running over. I'm blessed going out, and I'm blessed coming in. I will be blessed. And I say to you, Satan, according to God's word, it says when the thief is discovered, he has to return sevenfold, seven times, everything you've stolen. So in the name of Jesus, I command my return. My sevenfold return is coming back to me. My harvest is coming. I thank you, Lord. For a brand new beginning. in Jesus' name. Give him a praise if you believe that. And the last one I want to do today, if you're really serious about your destiny, I want to lead you in a declaration about your destiny. So if you stand again, here we go. Ready? Let's don't mumble. Let's shout this one because I'm concerned about my destiny. Are you ready? I declare I am special and extraordinary. I'm not average. I'm custom made. I'm God's masterpiece. One of a kind. I keep my head held high, knowing I'm a child of God. I was made in His image. That's my declaration. I declare God's dream for my life will come to pass. I won't be stopped by people, disappointments, or adversities. God has solutions to every problem that I'll ever face. The right people, the right breaks are in my future. I will fulfill my God-given destiny. And that's my declaration. I declare it's not too late to accomplish everything that God has placed in my heart. I have not missed my window of opportunity. God has moments of favor in my future. He's preparing me right now because He's about to release a special grace to help me accomplish the dream. This is my time. This is my moment. And I will receive it. If you believe that, let's take the next 10 seconds and let's give Him praise. Let's give Him praise. Come on, shout. We praise God. We rejoice in Him. Yes. Thank God. Thank God. Thank God. Hallelujah. We praise You, Lord. You may be seated. Let's bow our heads and just begin to pray about just sort of settling in what God has been saying to us today. Father, I just pray right now, and I ask that we don't just hear Your word today, but we do Your word. In the areas where we've been negative in our inner dialogue, help us to replace those with the truth of Your word. As you just silently keep praying today right where you're sitting, there's some of you today that there's a confession, just one confession that you need to make. And here it is. Three simple words. I need Jesus. The amazing thing is, if you're really honest, you think about your life and you say, man, I've done some things that are wrong. I've done some things that I feel very guilty for right now. And how in the world could I ever reconcile this with God? Well, the amazing thing is, God is so good that He did something that we could never deserve or earn. He sent His Son Jesus, who was perfect without sin. Jesus gave His life so that we could know the goodness of God. The scripture says this, anyone who confesses with their mouth that Jesus is Lord and believes in their heart that God raised Him from the dead, that person will be saved. There are some of you here today, you recognize you're really distant from God in your heart. You're one confession away from surrendering to Him, calling on Him. Just simple. Jesus, I need You. And I believe that You're the Son of God. See, when you confess with your mouth and believe in your heart, your sins are forgiven. There are those of you who recognize today, I need forgiveness. I need God's grace. It's not an accident that you're here today. But it's a time for you to start new and fresh, to be forgiven by Jesus. All you have to do is say to Him today, yes, I surrender my life to You. If that's you while this church is praying and the heads are bowed, if that's you and you'd say, you know what? I want to say yes to Jesus today. I never thought I could. I never thought he'd come into my life. I never thought I'd be that. And I never thought I really amounted to anything. But if that's you today and say, you know what? I need Jesus. Would you raise your hand and make eye contact with me? I want to lead you in a prayer in just a minute. Go ahead. Just raise your hand. Thank you in the back. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you in the back. Thank you. Others today, just lift your hand. Thank you, sir. Thank you. Hands going up all over. The Lord's still speaking to others today. I mean, your palms are sweaty. Your heart's beating a little faster. Oh, you're not having a heart attack. God's just overwhelming you with his love. You say, yeah, but I've gone to church a little bit, you know, so I'm okay. No. Confess with your mouth. Believe in your heart. Raise your hand. Let me pray with you today. Yeah, that's me. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you. Thank you. These people are so honest today. Thank you, sir. Let's pray this prayer together. Lord Jesus, I thank you today for giving your life for my sins. You died in my place. And so I confess with my mouth today that you're my Lord and Savior. And I believe that in my heart. Please forgive me of my sins. Come into my life. As best as I know how, I'm going to serve you the rest of the days of my life. In Jesus' name. Look, if you prayed that prayer with me today and you raised your hand, or maybe you prayed the prayer and you didn't raise your hand, I have a little book that I want to give you called Now What? Anita and I put this together just to help you to take the next step. So would you raise your hand again back here and here and here and over here and here and here and over here. Raise your hand again. I want to raise your hand. Come on, church. Let's celebrate today. Let's celebrate today. Come on, church. Look, if you prayed that prayer today, fill out that connection card and on the back say, today I recommitted my life to Jesus, or I became a first-time follower. Would you do that? And in just a minute, the ushers are coming to receive the tithe and offering, and drop that connection card in the box. If you're a first-time guest or if you've never filled out a card, would you fill that out today and drop that in the box? I want to send you a little handwritten note this week and say thank you for coming. We're so glad that you did. And we drop our change in the bucket because in the next month is Teacher Appreciation Month, and we're doing a bunch of stuff for the teachers in the Oak Park Middle School and the Leesburg Elementary School and in our Learning Center. We're just going to treat our teachers great, all right, because they deserve it. So ushers are coming at this time to receive the tithe and the offering. Go ahead and finish out your connection card. If you're not ready to give today, there's a giving envelope in the chair in front of you. You can fill that out and drop it. Let me pray for you today. Would you hold your tithe, your offering, or hold your card up today? Father, we bring to you the tithe and the offering. We thank you for caring for us. We love you with all of our heart today, and we bring to you the tithe that is yours, and over and above that, the offering. And Lord, we're just going to drop change in and change the world by changing teachers' lives and letting them know that we encourage them. And Father, we just thank you today in your name. Would you go ahead and give? Drop your connection card in there. Don't miss next week. Bring somebody with you. Ladies, bring the hat. Men, let's come dashing. Let's make it. Come in shorts if you want, you know, shorts and a nice tie. That'll do good. Or if you don't have a tie, just come, all right? Just come. We just want to see. It's going to be a great time, a wonderful time. Let's stand and let's sing a little bit more of this song. And if I haven't met you, I'm going to be out in the foyer. I'd love to meet you. Drop by and get an Oscar's donut and say hi and introduce yourself.
Let's declare this song together.
Waking up knowing there's a reason. All my dreams come alive. Life is for living with you. I've made my
worship this morning. If you need prayer for anything, our prayer team is going to be out front on either side of the stage. And if it was your first time, go on out to the foyer because our pastors are out there and they would love to meet you. Go out and find someone new. Make a friend. Be thinking about who God wants you to invite for this coming Sunday, Easter. We love you. Have a great week.